So in some William Lane Craig, I'm sure you know who he is. He's a very popular Christian debater. He'll give evidences for why it's reasonable to believe in God, but he'll say that he has said that, you know, these evidences are what I would give in a debate, but personally, that's not the reason why he believes. He believes mostly because he has a personal relationship with Jesus. And a lot of Christian apologists will say that, you know, I have a relationship with God just like I have a relationship with my wife. And just like I wouldn't doubt the existence of my wife, I wouldn't doubt the existence of, you know, God, because I could feel this. And I would say that that is a logical fallacy of appeal to emotion, that you cannot determine if something exists or not based on your feelings. And one story I give about that is I talked to some Mormons, and they said, pray about the Book of Mormon. If it's true, God will give you a burning in the bosom. I prayed about it, I got the burning in the bosom, and I was a Mormon for about 5 seconds because my brain kicked in and said, Bernie, you can't believe this because of what you know. I knew too much about the Book of Mormon that I knew it was a sham religion. So even though my feelings led me astray, my brain saved me, in effect. And so I once was an evangelical born-again Christian. I know what it feels like to be led by God. That's when somebody says they're led by God or they feel the presence of God. I know that, and I now believe is a delusion. So what is your take on all of this?
Yeah, well, that's interesting, because there's a fascinating argument that Richard Swinburne, who is a philosopher of religion, is also a theist, but there's an interesting argument that Swinburne advocates, and it's called the argument from religious experience. And he basically is arguing that when you look at Christians around the world today, in fact, throughout church history, you have a very large number of Christians that report basically having religious experiences, and that he would basically argue that these religious experiences have a profound effect on people's lives, universally making them a better people, more loving and more sacrificial, and that these experiences seem to be very real to the people that have had them. And so he argues that if someone has an experience, again, like a religious experience, and it's rational to conclude that they actually had that experience, unless there are some specific reasons why we would think that they are deluded. And, you know, it's possible that some people very well could be deluded when it comes to, again, claiming to have religious experiences. But it's unreasonable to think that everybody who claims to have had those experiences would be deluded, and that we should take those statements at face value unless, again, we have reasons not to think that's the case. And, in fact, that's the same principle, according to Swinburne, that we would use in a court of law. Where if somebody claims that they've observed something or have had an experience, that we assume it to be true unless there's reasons we think that it isn't true. I mean, that's essentially what we do when we have eyewitnesses that are, you know, presumably have seen a crime being committed, is that we assume that their testimony is reliable unless we have reasons to think otherwise. So, you know, I would argue that I think those religious experiences that Christians have are real experiences and is a legitimate reason to believe in God.
Well, so what do you think about me praying about the Book of Mormon and getting the feeling from God about it? We both agree that the Book of Mormon is a work of fiction, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so I agree with that. How do you explain that? I mean, I think it's actually a pretty brilliant move, because I think what happened in psychologically is that if you're an honest person and you honestly, with all your heart, are seeking the truth, there's something emotional that happens that, I don't know, I think there was something emotional there. It was some kind of a trick. And it may be a trick where somebody can really bond with you while they'll say, like, you know, let's be honest, come on, you know, and then I don't know, it just does something to you, like it puts your armor down, you know, arms down or something, I don't know.
Well, I mean, you know, I've been sincerely prayed to see if the Book of Mormon was true. I prayed with Mormon missionaries, and I've never had that burning in my bosom. And so I didn't have that experience. It's not to say that people who are Mormons didn't have that experience, but I never had that experience.
But I have had
what I would say, authentic religious experiences. In fact, that was one of the key reasons that I converted to Christianity. Is I was reading through the Sermon on the Mount, and I was by myself actually in a chemistry lab, and it was in the evening, and I was reading through the Sermon on the Mount. I was at that point convinced that there was a creator that existed, but had no conviction otherwise as to who or what that creator was, and was reading the scriptures based on the encouragement of a pastor who I had, had an interaction with. And it literally was as if there was a presence in the room with me while I was reading that passage, and I had the overwhelming conviction that this was true. And I've never had an experience like that before that, and I never had an experience like that afterwards. And so I would say that was a genuine experience that I've had. And so that's not the sole reason why I believe in Christianity, but that was, again, a real experience that I had. It was a real experience, just in the same way that seeing the sunset or the sunrise is a real experience for me. That convinces me that the sun is that the sun exists, and that the earth is rotating around the sun, or mm-hmm. revolving around the sun.
You know, you talk about this real experience. It reminds me when I was earlier, as a Christian, I was with a group and we were studying Neil Anderson's The Bondage Breaker, I believe it is. And he talks about all these demon stories, and people in the group were getting demonic things. And I remember praying and feeling a presence sometimes, and like waking up and looking out, and I see there's a cross on the wall, and it's coming from the blinders because of the holes in the blinders, and it's like I see a cross there, and some people in the group are getting all these freaky things, and what we were talking to the pastor about, it's like, why is this stuff happening to us? And it's like, well, it's probably because we're getting into the spiritual realm. When you go into the spiritual realm, the devil's fighting back. And then I started going to a Calvary Chapel where they were saying, how the Toronto Blessing and all these spiritual things are just going off the rails, basically. And so my mind kind of got cleared up, a little bit more sane, I think. And then, of course, all those experiences went away, too. I wasn't so freaked out and, seeing everything spiritual and all that. So you can kind of see how where the head's at is how you interpret and see things. And almost freaking yourself out, like with dreams. In your dreams, you're freaking yourself out. It's your brain freaking out another part of your brain. So it's kind of a weird situation.
Yeah, well, and I think that it's important when somebody is having, thinks that they've had a religious experience, that you are, thoughtful about it, and that you do apply reason to that experience. I think that that those experiences that you had, in my opinion, could have been very real experiences, and I'm sure they felt real to you at the time.
Yeah, it definitely felt real. Yeah, but I mean, now I think it's a bunch of mind games. Yeah, you see hypnosis, and they can plant. There's so many ways to trick the mind. If you know Darren Brown, who's a mentalist, who's very famous in the UK, he has so many YouTube videos about all kinds of religious nature. I mean, there's one where he's an atheist, and he actually converted another atheist to Christianity, and then he had to deconvert him and tell him the tricks he used and stuff. So, I don't know, it seems to me the mind could be manipulated pretty easily with hypnosis and suggestions and things like that. And then I think what can really save you is when you have knowledge. So for example, somebody says, here's a holy book, like the Book of Mormon. You could gobble that up and believe that, but if you know enough about history and if you even look at what the critics say about it, you can say oh yeah, of course this is nonsense. And so it really takes the brain to save the heart, because if you didn't have that brain knowledge, your heart would just go haywire just following any kind of weird thing. The Heaven's Gate cult, or all kinds of things.
Well, you know, and I would agree with that. And you know, from the point that I converted to Christianity, and I would argue that a significant part of that conversion process involved coming to the intellectual conviction that there was a creator that existed, and then, of course, asking the question who that creator was. But then afterwards, it was continuing applying a test of reason to scriptures and to the claims of the Christian faith. And so from my perspective, you know, I see the creation accounts in scripture as having scientific credibility. I see the Christian faith as having historical credibility. I think, you know, when you even look at the person of Christ, his life, his death, and his resurrection, there's a very powerful, you know, and compelling historical argument one could make that I think Mormonism lacks in terms of the Book of Mormon or the Book of Abraham or the Pearl of Great Price. And so I think there are ways in which you can, you know, use reason to evaluate those experiences that you had and to evaluate the faith system or the philosophical system that you embrace.